The song is called I Am The Colour. This song is probably one of the most powerful songs on this album. It's a statement of who I am and my experiences. The beautiful thing about music is that we can connect to people from all different backgrounds, different cultures, different ethnicities, different, you know, what, no matter what they believe in, that music is this connector that just breaks down all the barriers of beliefs, of colour, of, you know, whatever. And every song, but this song I got had the honour and the privilege of having the incredible Jordan Gavet on this song and Scribe. I wanted Scribe on the song from the get-go, from when the idea came to my head 5 years ago. I was in this time and I had just been seeing too much and letting too many things fall by the wayside in terms of comments and how we were treated, how we're still treated and looked at differently. I'm in a position as Stan Walker. I'm the exception to the rule. Is it rule to the exception to the rule? Where I'm not one of those. I'm not one of these people. So I'm privy to see how people at the top tables really think. I'm privy to see how the suits really think and what they really want to say about my people. For example, there's lyrics in the song where I wrote, you know, expressways, expressway, about how people feel about me. I'm good enough, but they don't want to hear, but not to say a thing. They just want me to sing. This is a bit of a few different experiences combined into one kind of thing. Express lanes at the airport, because, you know, I'm bougie. Yeah, it's travel express lane. You know, I've got my air points, I'm on, I fly a lot. And so every time I've gone to the express lane and I've wore a hoodie, they'll stop me and go, no, no, you're over here, sir. Just because of my appearance of what I'm wearing, they'll stop me. And then they'll go, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry, Stan Walker. Or if I show them the express card, then they're like, oh, I'm so sorry. But they just stop me just on appearance. People have died on appearance. People have died because they've thought somebody was this. And that is so small and minute compared to the bigger scheme of things in terms of appearance. But it just goes to show that you're less and that you're not worthy enough because you look a certain way, you're dressed a certain way. First of all, you're there to usher me into the lane that I deserve to be in. So that would always happen to me. And then I would get told constantly, don't talk about this, that's too hard, it's too harsh to share on TV. Don't talk about this stuff. Talk about your experiences. That's, you know, people don't want to hear about that. That's too abrupt. Talk about real life experiences. They don't want to hear that stuff. People only wanted me to sing. They didn't want me to talk about what I'd been through because it was too confronting for them. But the thing is, I have to be honest and I have to share my experiences, and the most powerful thing that I have is the word of my testimony. That's how I help people, that's how I save people. But people don't like that because it's too confronting for them. It's not nice, it's not cute, it's not sellable, it's not a superstar thing to do. And so I'd kind of been fed up, and this song talks about my life in this industry, being a brown Māori man. And you know, I talk about, you know, like I gotta speak my mind. There's a lot on my mind. They're scared of what I say next. I'm just waiting for the same text, waiting for somebody to text me and say, you shouldn't have said that. Talking about how I'm a brown boy in a white world. I never fit in, never good enough, they can't place me. Polynesian people, Māori people, Pacifica people, depending on your color, and this is all people with of color around the world, you're more because you're darker, you're less because you're thing, you know, there's all this colorism and everything. I didn't understand this growing up, but then they place that on you, and then you see it evidently within the industry when they're lightening your images, they're making you look like a whole different person. They, you know, from the images to the way talking about you, don't be too this, and like, oh no, that's a bit too thing, or are you gonna really wear that on stage, my taona? I was like, well, you're going to wear that jewelry that is probably fake that you got from Blumen Lavoso or whatever that shop was called. But, you know, just that was my experiences. And I, when we started this song, I started this song with Michael Fatkin and Vince in Sydney. And I got Jordan Gavet on it. I wanted her to share her story, You know, we come from kind of similar backgrounds in terms of, you know, being brought up in Australia and New Zealand, her being Samoan, me being Māori, and trying to fit into the different crowds and trying to find our kind of place of belonging within certain people groups and in foreign lands and foreign places, and then sharing our experiences of our upbringing, her sharing her experience of her upbringing, and talking about her grandmother being in the Dawn Raids, but her grandmother being her strength and her grandmother being the example and the pillar of hope and strength in her family, that she has that same kind of like mana and attitude that, you know, she's not going to falter, that she's not going to bend or be swayed by anything. Then when I got Scribe on, you know, him talking about growing up in Christchurch, being a Samoan man, being hated and being, you know, being disrespected, but, you know, when it comes to his flow and when it comes to his rapping and to his music, people couldn't, they had to love him because he was the man. There's nobody that's ever been like Scribe. Nobody has ever, there's never going to be another Scribe. There's only ever one Scribe, and I had to have him. I had to have the legend. I had to have him. He's the man. Like, he's just one of the most incredible artists, I think, for myself, to ever come out of New Zealand, ever, in all genres. He's the man. There's never been someone like him. And I wanted him on the song to share his story. And I wanted our three stories to come together, because we've all shared similar experiences in terms of being brown people and in this industry, and going between the different countries and feeling displaced in your own home and displaced in these different countries, and trying to find communities and trying to latch on to anything and to latch on and hold on to our culture. So this song is an important piece, and we're just so proud of who we are. We're proud of that, because that colour, it's also a metaphor for that's our DNA, that's our whakapapa, who we come from. You know, we are who we are because of who we come from and where we come from. And so this song was just turned out into, I feel like, a piece of art that expresses our own individual stories, brings it together, brings us together as a people. Yeah, this song is probably the biggest songs on this album in terms of a statement, and a statement that I feel like is done in a beautiful way. It feels like a movie track. It's a movie of our lives. And again, we weren't trying to make music that sounded like anything else than what we felt at that time. And I've been very intentional about everything and every single song and the production and who's worked on it, who's sung on it. We had Nate singing all the BVs on this, singing all over that, having, it's like our people that are just like weaved into the song, from production to writing to singing to rapping to the features, everything. I wanted it to like be the DNA of us and not just me. All in, you know, all of us are in this. And so this is I Am the Colour. Same time, same city, love me because the flow was the coldest. And it's so sick, I spread the COVID. And the cops.